The year 2007 proudly marks the 25th anniversary of the San Francisco Basque Cultural Center. Let us look back on its beginnings and appreciate the efforts of those first few who planted the seeds of the dream of having a permanent place to call Gure Eskual Etxea.
For years, the Basques in San Francisco had longed for a place that could be called their own, a place where friends could gather, a place where pelota could be watched and played, a place where their children could learn and continue the ancient traditions. As the old familiar Basque restaurants began to close one by one, as the Basques in San Francisco began to scatter throughout the Bay Area, and finally when the pelota court at Helen Wills Playground closed, we feared that the Basques in the Bay Area may be through, unless that dream became a reality. And so our dream has come true. The Basque Cultural Center stands as a sign of our belief, dedication, and love. A place we can call our home. A place where we can gather. A place where we can watch and play pelota. A place where our children can learn, live, and continue our ancient Basque traditions. Gure Etxea, our home. And all of this because we had a dream.
You're one of the seven founders of the Basque Cultural Center. On this 10th anniversary, can you recount the beginnings of this this cultural center?
Yes, I think I can. Back in February 1979, we were still bowling or playing ball at Larkin. I think it was Broadway and Larkin, Miles Park. And at that time, we found out that they were going to turn down the building. And here we were without any place to play ball.
Handball,
that's right. And so I was talking to a couple of guys in there. As a matter of fact, Francho Vidarreta, Kosamani Miura, and I mentioned, well, maybe we should start looking for land, and maybe between a few Basque people, we should build a handball court. That's how all got started. We tried to contact a few handball players, see if they want to participate, and we had the first meeting shortly after, sometime in February, and by that time already I was looking for some properties, some land to buy, and the first idea was to build in San Francisco, but it was almost impossible because it takes a big piece of property, and there was nothing available, and also was too expensive. So we started looking outside in the peninsula. We figured that would be the closest to San Francisco. And we had about three pieces of property at that time that were available. One in Millbrae, one in Burlingame, and this one in South City. After that meeting, we had another meeting, I think it was in March, at the French church in the hall, and 73 people showed up in there. And from 73 people, everybody that was there was very motivated that we should have something for the Basque people in the area. So we elect some members, temporary, we made like a temporary what they call a committee. And I was elected the president, Kosamani Miura vice president, Leon Franchistegui treasurer, Leon Sorondo was secretary, and then we had Felix Berwet as a director, Raymond Caballero, Jean Jorec. We are seven all together. We start working on it, and then we had a lawyer, Marcel Biscay, which he offered us to form the corporation, and that's how we start the beginning. That's the beginning. And by that time, we had approximate, we didn't know how much it was going to cost. Our goal that time was around $600,000-$700,000, including the land. And so everybody had to put up some money. And at the time, we had some pledges, and people came with $3,000-$4,000 per members at that time. More like 1,000, but some of it $3,000-$4,000. And so we decided to go ahead and to really work on it and purchase the property, which took maybe 2-3 months of negotiation. And then we had to get an architect. We hired George Scarvo at that time. He did all the plan here. We had to get the premise from the city, and that was a lot of hassle also to get the permits, because this was something different that nobody else has done, especially the handball court. This is the only one probably in the United States. It's an international handball court, and it's got 42 feet high walls, and it's a big court, and so they never had anything done like that before. They never seen it, so everybody was afraid to even look at it. But after explaining what it was for, and so they all give us the okay to do it. June or something like that, 1979, we formed the full board with 15 people, and we added to the seven committees. We had Jean Couricet and Marcel Durquet, Marcel Biscay himself, Louis Helou, Gracien Goyenech, Augustin Dard, Jean-Baptiste Saperat, and Jacques Marcel Biscay. So those were the first 15 full directors, and then we proceed, especially I was more involved in the planning stage, but most of the directors were in charge of getting the money to build. Well, we were, for a little while, we were a little bit discouraged because people were not responding like we expected, but after contacting everybody that in the community that we really we need a facility like this, people start realizing maybe we gotta help them a little bit more. So we finally people come up with more money, and a lot of them was not donations but loans, and then we're still paying back those people. And we had loans up to well, probably $1 million altogether. And we, at the present time, we're doing really good paying those loans back. One of the biggest problems we had is to convince the people and to have faith that such a thing could be done. A lot of people didn't think they couldn't realize will materialize such a thing. So that was one of the hardest things. But even until it was completed, they couldn't see what was going to happen. And a lot of people don't understand the plans and things like that. So, but once the building was finished, then they realized, oh, Jesus, it's a nice thing. And now they were happy. And people that they were against it in the beginning, then they realized, well, they were wrong. And they
to see to believe.
That's right.
Yeah, we were a few contractors, and it was really a lot of help in there. And then with other members together, we really worked hard and put this thing together in a short time. We didn't use too many outside contractors.
So we pulled all the talents of contractors, bass contractors.
Bass contractors and painters and everybody else that had a talent. And then we did a lot of labor work, so there was a lot of people in there, and they really helped us. And I was happy to see that they were interested in helping. We started this construction in in March 1981, and by February 15, 1982, the place was open.
As the Bass Cultural Center enters into the 21st century, is there anything you'd like to say to the younger members?
Well, yes, I would like to say to the future generation that we build the foundation of the Basque heritage, and we like to see them continuing with the same effort and love that like we did. And not only for the first generation, but all the generations to come. And they will continue the tradition of the Basque culture. Eta orai, nahi nuke eskuaraz bihitzeran, nahi nuke eluden gazteri erran, eta segidezaten guk hasi lana, eta aniz demoraz, eta mentuaz betikotz. Gure guk emanduan amodio berarek ilan. Esker milanitz.
You and your husband Ganesh were the first restaurant managers of the Basque Center. Can you recall those first days?
Very well. Well, we came there 1 week before we opened the restaurant. And there was so much work to be done. And we thought, we never gonna be able to open this place in the coming Sunday. But everybody was there early in the morning, those workers and contractors, and early in the morning until late in the night. And by Thursday night, was done, at least more or less. So on Friday morning, everybody came, all the gardeners and painters, contractors, everybody with their truck to clean up the place, because that was such a mess. The whole building was nothing but mess. All the sheet rocks and paint, anything, everything was there, tools and everything. So in a few hours, they clean up the whole place. That was incredible, so much action, so much enthusiasm, so much love. When they were going out with the trucks full of debris, can say. Delivery trucks were waiting at the gate. So the debris were going out and the delivery truck were waiting in that to find some decent place to unload their truck. The first day of opening was only for the members. So the money, finally we got the most beautiful day of our life, I think. The opening of the center to our members. Angel Goyenech, she baked enough gâteau basque for 500 people. That was she did all that in her house, you know, in the family stove.
And the opening day of the restaurant to the public
was February 14, 1982, and then we. The restaurant was closed for 1 week because everything wasn't ready. We had the dining room was four naked walls. Was nothing there, not one shelf in the bar, not one drawer. And from the day one, the people, you know, the business was booming. We were doing 80, 90 launches. And then at night, Friday and Saturday, there were 260, 300. But we aren't prepared for so many people. So we aren't many people to work either there. We had two waitresses, Marie Hélène Ascona and Marie-José Zavala, and then Coche Marie Pagola. And then in the kitchen was Gabriel. And but you know, we were so many people. The people complained in the lunch time. You know, we took too long, so we hired some more people, and then one more for the kitchen, Jean-Pierre Minaverri. And then we had only one phone between the two bars, and the bar was closed. I mean, you know, that wasn't that flap to open, so we had to go under the bar and. My back was black and blue. the beautiful chimney was there, though. By Frederick Fulden, he handcrafted with the seventh province, Basque province. It was beautiful. Everybody admired it. On Friday, before the opening, we had a Basque club banquet on that Sunday. And then we were preparing the room and everything. And two gentlemen from the city came to me and said, hey, what are you doing? We saw the advertising in the newspaper and that your opening day is coming to Monday. But you have no permit to serve food. I say, oh my God, what are we doing now? So I called Gorostia Gradway, and he told me, go to the city hall and explain the case, and I'd be there too. So I went to the city hall, and over there they checked the papers, and I said, yeah, no, this your club is supposed to be open only for the club functions, not to the public. And so Gorostia also came in the meantime, and so they discussed, so I went home. Back to the center, and he came back, and he said, well, you know, ignore all that and open the place, don't worry. What? We cannot open the place like that. And he said, yeah, go ahead. Don't say anything to anybody and open. So I was so scared. But anyway, we opened the place, and we all led to the South San Francisco City. They knew we were open, but apparently they closed their eyes.
Finally, inauguration day. Dedication ceremonies included congratulations from proud city officials, as well as dignitaries from France and Spain.
Ladies and gentlemen and children, on behalf of the City Council, Vice Mayor Roberta Tellia, Past Mayor Ron Acosta, Mitch Damani, and Mark Ediego, and myself, we'd like to take this opportunity to thank you for inviting us to this very wonderful day for South San Francisco. I think it's a renaissance, I think, from what was in this location and what is here. I think it's a monument to the living, and I'm the city of South San Francisco so grateful. I would like to say, Ongi Etori to San. I'd like to present to the president this proclamation. I'll say mil esker.
Mr. Mayor, City Council, and all the citizens of South San Francisco, I thank you for the proclamation. Thank you.
The planting of the Guernica tree in front of the center was one of the most moving events of the day. Carlos Urrutia brought a young oak tree that he grew himself from a seed harvested from the original Guernica oak of the Basque Country.
Our dream of many years has finally become a reality. I would like to take this opportunity to thank the chairman, his committee, and all volunteers for organizing this inauguration ceremony and festivities. Thank you all, and have a great time.
After the ceremonies, the fun began with exhibition games of Yokogarbi, featuring players from Euskadi. And of course, the center's own handball players also showed their talents in the new cancha.
Ten koma ventanga nisha. Ah, lua.
The games were followed by traditional song and dance performances by the Satsbyak Bat group. During dinner, which was held in the cancha, the Algeri King Choir sang under the direction of Martin Subieta and Jean Mazaris. The first dinner dance after the ceremony was held in the banquet hall. Music was provided by Alain Erduzansi and his band. On Sunday, the center's first mass was celebrated by Father Jean-Pierre Cacheneau, the Basque chaplain, and Father Ferrango of Notre-Dame des Victoires of San Francisco, accompanied by the clica, choir, and dancers. Celebrations culminated on Sunday evening with dance music played by Jean-Louis Corrochet and Alain and Maurice Negelois. The center's popularity grew rapidly. Events were already booked a year in advance. The first wedding celebration was for Roger and Monet Monzon. Traditional Basque dance music was first performed by local young Basque musicians, Alain Erduzansi, Jean-Louis Corrochet, the Negelois brothers, Jean Fletcher, René Caballero, and Daniel and Christian Iribarin. And let's not forget Jean-Paul Barthes, the center's first DJ who brought his rock style of music to the stage. And even 25 years later, more mellowed, he still performs. Dance music was also provided by popular accordion players Michele Corino, the Muschi brothers, and Michel Galandre. Michele Corino and Michel Galandre even gave accordion lessons to Basque children such as Diana Echeverri, Idoya Salaburu, and Isabelle Ossefrin. Also, entertainers from Euskadi have performed at the center, like Louis Berech, Aran Saliak, Baitale, Esti Chu, La Tuna de Toledo, Imanol.
Zergatik ikasi anztekoz gero ikasiak oro zergatik ikusi hainbertze lurralde hainbat, hainbat jende
Michel Telechea Vituria and Tapia Louis Camblor Eramun Marti Corena
Era da Kirin Sina Non di che lo isa
Jean Bordaccia and his group Juan Marie Beltran Michel Echeverri Pompey Portugal and groups like Quecho, Alegerac and so many more. The Entertainment Committee was formed to organize such performances, and to this day its chair, Pierre Echeren, makes sure that there's always a lot of fun activities to bring together Basque families of the Bay Area and beyond. One of these activities is playing moose.
Moose, I would say the moose is a game who keeps the Basque people together. So you don't need to be young, you can, moose is one game you can play it at every age, any age. We have a moose on every club, and NABO's got this tournament every year. And then we have an international moose also every year in different countries. Last year, the Basque Center's champions, Noel Erdozensi and Ramon Largu were also champions of NABO, and they went to Chile. Mexico won, but they got third place. So we've been doing fairly good. But San Francisco never got first place. But believe me, they're looking forward to go to those tournaments. And this year, Basque Cultural Center, we got two ladies who are champions of the center, and they will be competing for NABO, and if they win, they will be going to Mar del Plata, Argentina.
Another committee soon created was the Women's Club, which brings together the members' young children.
Well, we started the Women's Club, basically, we got together, group of women, and we started it for the kids. We wanted our kids to get together, to know each other, to play with each other. We kind of figured that we'd be at the center often on Sundays, so we might as well introduce our kids and have them, play together. So that's how we started it. We wanted, I think the first event we had was the Christmas party. We had the first Christmas party. It was a Saturday afternoon, and we had refreshments for the kids, and we had a magician at the same time. And it was really nice. You know, maybe 20, 25 kids, if you know, can't really remember, way back to 1982, I guess, but it was nice. And then from then we decided that, you know, parents, grandparents couldn't be there on Saturday to watch the kids, so we decided to do it on a Sunday. So from then the tradition became that we did Christmas parties on Sunday afternoon. We'd have lunch, and then we'd have Santa Claus, and now we have Olencero, and that's how the tradition began. Parties just developed after that. The Easter party developed. We used to do it Palm Sunday, and we got an Easter bunny who would come and give treats to the kids. We did Halloween, the same kind of thing. The kids would get would put costumes on, and then we'd have a little contest to see which one was the best costume or which one was the funniest costume. And then we gave money. I think it was a $2 bill to each of the children who participated. We decided that we'd have a Halloween party for the adults as well. You know, people got dressed in costumes, and we gave prizes to the best costumes. We had about, I don't know, 12, 15, even Jean Paul, I know, participated a couple of times with his costumes.
Is that how you recognize?
And we would do a Mother's Day lunch. Mother's Day comes, and so the women would all get together, and we gave each woman a ticket as they walked in, and then we had prizes or presents for them. So we had a raffle, and you know, whoever won got a really nice present. And then we did Father's Day as the same thing. First couple of years we did Mother's Day, and then it was like, well, why not Father's Day? So we said, okay, so we decided to do Father's Day as well in June. Again, we gave the men a free ticket, and we had a raffle, and we gave out presents. We also decided that we would treat ourselves to a Reno trip. The first year we decided it was just going to be all women. And then some women thought, oh, why can't we bring our husbands? So the first year it was all women. We were 40, 45 women on the bus. Susie Arrozarena, our secretary, took pictures of everything as a memorable getaway. And then the second year it was like, okay, if you want to bring your husbands this year, you can bring your husbands. So we made it a co-ed kind of bus after that.
A new annual event is Grandparents' Night.
They started that a couple of years ago, having a Grandparents' Day. And then we take pictures with the grandkids, and I think last year they had a dinner where it was just the grandparents and the kids. Saspiak Bat Dance Group, the Clique and El Garaquin Choir, have also played an exceptionally important role in keeping the Basque culture vibrant and authentic. Valerie, you started out as a very young active dancer and member of the center. What was it like growing up with the center?
Well, I remember that it wasn't always part of our life. Before the center, we did dance practice here and there, wherever we could. I remember down on, I think it was Ortega, they were in a park rec facility, and then at the zoo, and then at the pier. And I remember, you know, the banquets and places that we would get together were NDV. I remember playing house in the closet at the NDV Church Hall. And then once the center started being built, it was kind of the focal point. It was the place where everything centralized. It was kind of nice to have everything in one area. And really, since its beginning, it's been just a major part of our lives. It's been our second home. And we've grown up with, you know, not only with the building and the location, but with the people in the community. Not only has the building been our second home, but the community has been our second family.
After so many years, the Saspiak Bat Dance Group finally found a home within the center to practice its dances. Under the guidance of Pierre Echerin, and more recently his daughter Valérie Echerin-Arechea, Families and friends enjoy watching their Shitwok perform at the center. A bass choir was in its early stages a few years before the center's walls went up. Matin Subieta came from Ushgadi to form the choir. His first rehearsal had fewer than 10 voices. Soon after, under the direction of Jean Mazaris, the Algarikin choir grew to well over 30 members, and even recorded professionally a cassette bearing its name.
Oh.
choir is currently conducted by Aita Marcel Tius. The youngsters are not part of the choir. They get to learn bass songs so as to join the choir a little later. The center also offers chistu lessons. The San Francisco Bass Cultural Center sponsored also the 2002 NABU Convention. A weekend of activities were held on the grounds of Orange Park, a block down from the center. Basque food, fun, and culture were spread across the park for the public to enjoy.
Welcome to everyone. Egun on ene parte zere eta ongi etorri.
Can I ask you, this is your first visit to the United States?
Yes. It's my first visit here. I came here with my two vicar general, and for us, very good human experience at first, and also a spiritual and pastoral experience.
I heard many times about the Basque in the United States and how they preserve their culture, but even though we've been impressed by seeing how they preserve their dances, their song, their language, the whole culture, and how attached they are to the culture and to the roots, and how they try to pass it on to the younger generations.
Saturday and Sunday, the center's hardworking volunteers served a delicious barbecue to over 1,000 people in the fronton. And of course, people danced in the banquet room late into the night. With a permanent fronton to call their own, Peloto players could now enjoy practicing and playing regularly. Soon tournaments were organized within the San Francisco Basque community, as well as with players from elsewhere, such as Fresno, Bakersfield, and Chino. The Peloto Committee has also sponsored international handball games. Its first mini mondial, with players from Mexico, France, Spain, and the United States, was held in 1984. The center's own players have also brought home medals from numerous international tournaments. While the first members enjoyed playing among themselves, they also recognized the importance of teaching their own children the game that in such a large part defines Basque culture. Volunteers such as Frédéric Huldin, Ganesh Iriatbor, Jean-Léon Ossafrin, Jean Bidard, Pierre Iliard, with so many more, gave their time in the beginning to teach the children the game. André Lard and Arnaud Duard soon after became the first official coaches who regularly worked with children on Saturdays.
My name is Anton Maxad and I'm 10 years old.
My name is Joe Yuri and I'm 14.
My name is Pache Spiros and I'm 13.
My name is Dominic Begay and I'm 13.
My name is Sean Edier and I'm 12.
My name is Alan Yurudi and I'm 13.
My name is Frank Machin and I'm 8 years old.
My name is Xavier Berota and I'm 11 years old.
My name is Dominic Alvarez Sedina, 13 years old.
My name is Erico Albrew and I'm 12 years old.
Roger Inchart Shah and I'm 11 years old.
I am a third grader and I'm 8 years old.
I'm Daniel Unas Vizcay and I'm 9 years old.
Thank you.
I'm not your coach.
André Lard. Okay. I'm 35 years old.
More than 20 years later, this same young player, Roger Inchart Shah, is now training a new generation. In 1993, the Basque Cultural Center had the privilege to host Pilotaren Biltzara, the annual convention of handball players from the Basque country. During the convention, members of the BCC were honored for their contributions to the game of pelota. Hooked on pelota, you'll still be playing well into your 60s and even into your 70s. A Basque community is not complete without its bertsolari. Over the 25 years, the Basque Center members have enjoyed listening to the singing improvisations of its own notables, Johnny Curuchet, Jesús Arriada, and Gracián Alfaro. Let's listen to what it takes to be a bertsolari.
To be a bertsolari, it's something that comes with you like any other things in your life. To me, I was all the appeal since I was a kid. I did hear my ancestors doing that, and it's something that stayed with me. And the best, really, most thing I know about it, it's especially in the occasions, you like to improvise songs according to the subject of that time. And then, especially when you're in competition or another versatility is facing you, by the time the other versatility has done half of, like the average public doesn't know, we do, pretty much the subject. By the third lane, we know pretty much what he's going to say, or she, whatever. And that time you got to start doing your own. It's why it's very important if the public is quiet, because you got no time to be distracted.
In 2003, the National Endowment for the Arts recognized the Bertularis' artistic contribution to the United States. Johnny Carruchetta and Jesus Arriada traveled to Washington, D.C. to perform their Bertu and receive their awards, along with Jesus Goñi and Martin Goicoechea. Let's not forget Charles and Jean-Baptiste Moustirats, always ready to lead the members in song during a banquet or sing an original bass song of their own. The Basque Cultural Center organizes events to recognize its members for their contributions to the Basque community and to the center. Honored members in the center's claim to fame, Ganesh Iriatbo, Amedi Sorondo, and Frederic Fulda. The Bizi Emancora Award for Lifetime Contributions to the Basque Center was given to Theodore Ondartz and Jean-Baptiste Goyenech in 2006. And in February 2007 to Joe Gastanchoa. Bill Etchegoyen and Jean Jaurech were posthumously honored at that time also.
Presented to Joe, Jean, and Bill, in recognition of your dedication to the Basque culture and contribution to the construction of the San Francisco Basque, South San Francisco.
Outside organizations have also honored the center's members. In 1991, the Society of Basque Studies of America inducted Louis Elou to its Basque Hall of Fame. In 2006, François Bidarrueta, Johnny Curuchet, Anya Iriatbor were also inducted. And posthumously, Frédéric Fulda and Jacques Unasu Biscay. Other Basque organizations, as well as non-Basque, have honored BCC members for their cultural and civic contributions. NABO and the French and Basque governments have bestowed distinguished awards to Jean-Léon Iribarren. Frédéric Fulda. Pierre Etcherin. Louis Marty Corena, Henri Lapouillade, Aïta Kachno, Jean Gorostiag. Aïta Tius, François Pédeflou, just to name a few. Let's not forget all the behind-the-scenes volunteers who have also contributed hundreds of hours of selfless service. Too numerous to mention here, but are recognized as the heart of the BCC.
Hogoita bortz urte baditu, zinela beratxotitu. Geroztik denak txoratu, bai behar dugu aitortu. Bete gaitu zu plazerrez, oi gure eskualetxea. Ongi etorri eginez, zabaldut zure atea. Biltzen duzu eskalduna, bai urbile eta urrundena, zuri esker da batasuna, gure arteko maitasuna. Hemen badugu pilotari, dantzari eta musikari, makilari eta persulari, bai eta ainitz kantari. Bete gaitutzu plazerrez, oi gure eskaletxea. Ongi etorri eginez, zabaldut zure atea. Hemen egiten txapelketa, museko ala pilota.
There are also BCC members who have brought attention to the adventurous nature of the Basque with their unusual feats and exploits outside the BCC. In 1989, Pierre Echeverry piloted his twin-engine Cessna from San Francisco to Biarritz, France, and back via the polar route. A trip that took going over 42 hours and 14 refueling stops. The return trip was 44 hours and 14 stops. His flight crew consisted of co-pilot Alan Stewart and flight attendant Jean-Paul Bart, who found renewed meaning in prayer while gaping at haunting icebergs below him. This unusual trip still remains a first among BCC members. Another BCC member, Jacques Agendigui, with his collection of unique automobiles, had won awards at many international car shows. His last, before passing away in 2007, was at the Concours d'Elegance in Pebble Beach, California, where in 2000, his 1937 Delahaye won Best of the Show. He had researched and restored this car part by part by himself, as he did his other one-of-a-kind autos, such as his Hispano Suiza, once owned by Pablo Picasso. Jacques was fondly known as Frenchy, or the Basco. His quiet manner and love for his cars earned him the respect and admiration among premier car collectors of the world. Among more recent endeavors, in 2003, a young member of the BCC, Joe Goyenech, biked across the United States from San Francisco to Washington, D.C. with his fraternity brothers. Their Journey of Hope team raised funds and awareness on behalf of the disabled. Joe especially rode in memory of his amachi, Marianne Goyenech Scully. After 3,900 miles and 63 days of pedaling with Basque muscle and heart, Joe, with the generous support of the BCC, was presented the top fundraiser award at Washington, D.C. In 2006, Patrick Echeverre also put his feet to the bicycle pedals and trekked 4,000 kilometers from Venice, Italy, through Croatia, Montenegro, Serbia, Albania, and culminating with a ferry ride to Greece. A trip that started out with four friends ended up after 29 days with only Patrick and one friend reaching their goal. François Bidarreta is one of those members who has worked in many different capacities for the Basque Center. You've been president of the BCC, and you've served on the board of directors for many years. And you are also a member of the BEO, the Basque Educational Organization. Tell us a little bit about the objectives and the activities of the BEO.
BEO was formed in the middle of the 80s. And the objectives of BEO right now were that also then and even now, that not only for the Basque people, that they're member of all the clubs like BCC or Basque Club or other Basque clubs, but also for the non-members, because the non-members of those Basque clubs, that usually they don't get the news of those clubs. So BCC tries to touch them also. Also BCC, that from the beginning that they had a going on that to teach Basque. First, some members of the Basque community here that they were doing it, and then with the Basque government, they were able to help us, and they sent us some teachers from the Basque country, and we did that for about 3 to 4 years.
So what are some other activities of the BEO?
Well, like every other year or so, we have the Basque Cultural Days, then we do different things, like in, I think it was in 2000 that we did the Shepherders Day, and that was mostly to get how the Basque Shepherders in the United States, how they live and stuff like that, and we collected, we interviewed quite a few of them, and there was a booklet made, and also video, and that was all done to really honor the Basque Shepherders also. And there was another one that BEO was involved with us, the Subi Suri. So that we had speakers there, and that they were talking about the Basque culture, about the Basque people, about where they come from, and all that. I remember one of the speakers' topic was about Basque hotels. Yeah, BEO is also involved right now that with Urrasande project. That what Urrasande committee is trying to put together is that the little bit of history of the Basque and Bay Area.
The final outcome of the Urrasande project then will be a compilation of documentations, interviews of the life of the Basque people in the San Francisco Bay Area.
Yeah, that's right. It's going to become a book, and it's going to be part of the bigger thing. Already there is one done in New York area and Boise area, and those are the United States, and then the same thing in other countries like Paris and you know that Argentina and Uruguay and I don't know how many other areas, and is going to be part of that.
What has the BEO done to promote contemporary Basque culture within the Bay Area?
We screened some newer films from the Basque country, and also to try to bring some young artists or groups that either musicians, you know, that the newer types. And I believe there'll be more and more young people interested in BEO to spread the word out, and I hope.
So the mission of the BEO's members will be to promote its Basque culture beyond the gates of the Basque Center.
Yes, that's what it always has been, and I hope in the future will be the same. Money.
Since the year 2000, the BEO has also established an annual scholarship contest for its members' children. Another popular BEO activity included putting on theatrical performances in the Basque language.
Amerikako bidea jagezazu jaungaztea Eganen dautzut nola biziden leku jatako gizona Hemen kobrea bezan asaiki handa bilate urrea
Esposgaztea
Cooking workshops are also very popular. The first one was given by Louis Marti Correna.
Pipoca. This is a real Basque dish that you can use for a lot of purposes. You can make a Basque omelette with it. You can make a chicken. You can use also for some fish. Later, we'll. I'm going to show you.
Over the past 25 years, Euskoaletxea has been spiritually guided by four Basque chaplains: Aita Jean-Pierre Cacheneau, Aita Jean-Pierre Echeverri, Aita Jean-Elisa Garay, and currently Aita Marcel Thius. Each one, with his unique and endearing personality, has left an indelible mark on the Basque community. Jean, it has been 25 years since the Basque Center opened. What changes have you seen since?
Well, I'm going to talk a little bit about the building and grounds which I'm involved. Yeah, back in 1979, when we purchased the property, it was about approximately 65,000 square feet. And between our property and the railroad avenue, it was a strip of land which we thought belonged to Southern Pacific, or was used by Southern Pacific. And after they discontinued the service in there, and so I approached the board of directors to find out, see if we could purchase that piece of property. After numerous meetings, finally, they 6 years or so, they say, okay, we will sell the land to you. So we come up with the price of $75,000, and we agreed. So we made a title search, and when the title search came back, we found out that they didn't own the property. Instead, it was owned by Utah Construction Company of Delaware, state of Delaware. And then the problem was to find someone who was responsible, so we could talk to them. And finally, after research, I locate the lawyer that representing the Utah Construction Company, and he happened to be in San Francisco. So I called him up and I made an appointment, and I went to see him, actually with Mali Echeverry. She was secretary of Bass Cultural Center, and we talked to him, and I explained to him that they had a piece of property in there. I showed him the deed and the map, and he didn't even know that they had a property in there. After talking to him, after having a long conversation, he deeded the property to us at no cost. His name was Richard Curuto, an Italian name, and he says that he knew about the Bass Cultural Center. He used to go there with his mother, have dinner sometime, and also he knew a few Bass people. And he says, I like the Bass people, and so he donated that piece of property to us. And actually, he wanted to give us the whole strip all the way to Spruce. And the board wasn't too excited to acquire that. It was free. And I didn't push it because I was so happy already to get that piece. Back in 1991 or so, we always have a problem with parking. All the festivals or big weddings, there was never enough parking. So it was Magnolia Street. And that Magnolia Street, we had a hard time to get in there because it wasn't paved or anything like that. It was nice weather, then the people could park in there. But a lot of time we had to ask permission to the city, and it was tough. We had to have liability insurance. And so anyway, I approached the board again to see if we could buy that property. And they said it was okay. And so I approached the city, and they were willing to negotiate. The price tag was around $200,000, and after we approved that too on the board, and what we did is that we made a title search again, and happened to be not to the city, but it was belonged to Utah Construction
again.
So I was so happy. I said, okay, now I go back to Richard Coruto to see him. And I went to see him and show him the map again, the strip. And he said, okay, I'll deed it to you again. So
twice donated.
Yeah, we had twice. So that's 19,500 square feet. The other one was 10,000 square feet. So we got 29,500 square feet at free. After all the property, we were able to extend our dining room, the kitchen, and also the parking lot. That was a big improvement. And since we did all those extensions, the business really boomed. They even built a little banquet room with the two bathrooms in there. And now we just finished a solarium in the back of the building, so glass enclosure. Also back, I think it was 97 or 98, I approached the city to see if we could lease a little piece of property in the back of our building to build a barbecue area. We were about 8 foot by 50 feet short, and I was able to acquire that little piece of property, and we're paying about $1 a month. I mean, $1 a year for leasing the property. That was a big improvement, because before we had a lot of problems when we were having barbecue. We had, a lot of time was raining and it was hard. This way, you know, it's covered barbecue area. That's another big improvement.
Francois Camus, you've been manager of the restaurant at the Basque Cultural Center for how long?
I came to the Basque Center March 1st, 1996. It will be 11 years finishing this March and starting my 12th year. Yeah.
And were you familiar with the center before?
Yes, I came playing handball from 11 years old. I played handball there. Later on, I came from when I was living in Monterey. I played with the Clica and played the Maquilari.
In the last 12 years, what changes have you seen here at the center?
When I came shortly thereafter, 4 months later, the restaurant was expanded. They added some more square footage to the dining room, which made it nice because the tables were very, very close to each other. So we still have the same amount of tables, but better situated. And we added the small banquet room, and they added the two more restrooms. So that was very helpful for the business. Yes.
What attributes to the success of the restaurant and banquet facilities?
I think, the property, the building, and the parking lot, and we're very competitive for all the hotels, and there's no restaurant that really has a banquet room. We have a lot of the San Bruno civic organizations that come here because they don't have anything in San Bruno, or they don't have anything in Millbrae. So, and besides our own South San Francisco, we have a lot of success with that.
From what I understand, the banquet facilities are booked years in advance now.
Yes, a year and a half to 2 years in advance they are booked. The large ballroom and the two smaller rooms are booked solid about 3 to 4 months in advance. But the big one, if you're planning a wedding, you have to start thinking a year and a half. Received a successful business award from the South City Chamber of Commerce. That was presented by Jackie Spears to me and to enter the Basque Center. And also in the last 6 or 7 years, we've been reviewed by the Zagat review. And also just as recent as 2 weeks ago, we had a big write-up in the Examiner. So it's nice that we get all this publicity.
The bar is famous for a couple of drinks. Could you talk about those two drinks?
With Joseph Jordan. Unfortunately, now it's been 2.5 years. He's not with us, but he's retired. And he had won an award for the Pecan in the contest in San Francisco. And then also he created the Shake and Quake cocktail 2 days after the 89 earthquake.
When you first came to the center as restaurant manager, who was the chef?
The chef was Patrick Farges, who had been there, or was there for 9 years. And then Louis went as a sous chef into the kitchen after I came. And then we got Michel Veron about 3-4 months later after I arrived. And Michel has been with us now 10 years. He left in between for about a year and a half. And then at that time we went through about 3 or 4 chefs. And then we were fortunate to get Michel back. And so Michel's with us now. And we also have two sous chefs now, Jean-Michel Duhalde and Philippe Garat. So we have a big crew in the back.
Of course, over the span of 25 years, many hardworking employees have been part of the BCC restaurant family. Among them, numerous BCC members and children of members. Thank you. Javier Berruezeta, you're the youngest president to be elected to the board of directors of the center. You also followed the footsteps of your father, Felix, who served on the board in its early years. Explain to us how you came onto the board and why.
Well, my interest in the center goes back to close to the days of when the center was built. But in particular, my earliest memories are at the center when the parking lot wasn't even built yet. It was a dirt lot, but yet the Pilotaris were already playing on this four walls. I don't think there even was the roof was on it, but they still wanted to play. I mean, the urge was there to play. Later on, I remember going to general meetings as a child, you know, when I was 11, 12, 13 years old, and the heated discussions that they had back then, and subsequently, I've always had an interest, for whatever reason, to get involved. And so subsequently, I decided to run for the board of directors in 1998. I didn't get on, but that's okay. It didn't discourage me, because the very next year, in 1999, I did run again, and I did get on the board. And I've been on the board since then, and I've been president since June of 2005.
As president, what are the goals and challenges you see for the future of the center?
The challenges that I see involved with the Bass Cultural Center and our community at the Bass Center are things that are not necessarily concerns within the community, but are concerns that our community has to deal with. Part of the great thing about living in the San Francisco Bay Area is, obviously, it's other than the fact that it's one of the greatest places to live in the world, and it allows for diversity and what have you. And it allows for communities and cultures like ours to be cultured or cultivated and nurtured. Is the negative to that, and I think it's a positive, it can be a positive, is the fact that we have so many things to do in the Bay Area. And so what does that do? People make choices. Do they go to the Giants game, or do they go to Kalika practice? Do they go to the Warriors game, or do they go to dance practice? Or do they play pilota? Or so with that, we have to find things that attract our members, kind of as a marketing piece to our members, to get involved in our community, primarily our younger ones, because those are the ones that we need to hook in to our community. Now, keep in mind too, the other challenges that we do is economic based. The Bay Area, as we all know, is an expensive place to live. The cost of living is going up, which causes, you know, our families to move out of the San Francisco Bay Area, well, farther into the outer parts of the Bay Area, due to cost of living, and, you know, they're trying to raise families. So now, even though the Bass Cultural Center and the four walls of the Bass Center is our Gure Escuela Etxea, it's our home base, we need to look and start doing things, and we have been, at least for the last 4 to 5, 6 years, activities that are non-traditional, doing activities that we as Basques already do. We need to do it with our own community within our Basques. People go to Giants games all the time. People go to Warrior games. People go fishing. People go bike riding. People, these are things that we do regardless.
As Basque Americans.
As Basque Americans. But now let's do it as a community together. Because we cannot guarantee the situation of the physical building, but we need to make sure that that community stays strong. Regardless, there's always a tie. And so, at the very earliest of ages, with Gois Escola, where children are involved at 2 and 3 years old, to youth activities that are well into their 20s, we give many options for the community to nurture and grow. And those are relationships that will last a lifetime. And so, I think with that in mind, a lot of our activities are geared towards that. We're not forgetting our past. We continue to do the traditional activities, but we also need to focus on the non-traditional activities for community building's sake.
And a few words in Basque?
Pues bai, berri zaren, nahi dut eskerrak eman, mire eskerra eman, gure gurasoei. Nolaz zuen ametsa da, baita ere gure ametsa, eta alba da segitiko dugu zuen hasien dena. Eta espero dugu gure aurrak baita ere segitzen dut hortan. eta baita ere eskualdunak mundu guziekoak alba dator zen alba dide gure eskoletxera eta etxean izateko zara eta besterik ez, eta agur.
As mentioned by Xavier Berueta, one way of community building is through sports activities. Of course, pelota is a traditional Basque sport, but younger Basque Americans also enjoy many other sports as well. Among such favorites, softball, baseball, and soccer. The BCC has even won the South San Francisco League Championship in softball. When the center organizes outings to sport events, the stadium scoreboards and big screens welcome the San Francisco Basque Cultural Center members. The center's members are found hiking, biking, skiing, rafting the American River, and having fun at Great America. The Basque spirit of sport and play have definitely spread beyond the gates of the center. The members of the San Francisco Basque Cultural Center have seen a dream come true in building their Gure Etxea. Throughout the past 25 years, at least four generations of Basque and Basque Americans have walked through its doors. Basque traditions and spirit are firmly implanted within its walls, all the while continuously evolving into a dynamic community across the San Francisco Bay Area.
Zeharkatuz Ita zoroit Ta iganak Udazken koloretan Landen lurrinak Zeharkatuz Ita zoroit Ta iganak Zuaitz biluziaren Erizpean hor bondoa, hor belaren hilobi.
The San Francisco Basque Cultural Center's founders and first members will have left behind a proud legacy. To their future members, they say, Sorionak eta segi olola.
Tostoa xume bezain ede Aixolia bereri hortzean Zubaiz guztiaren bizkortasunez Hain betea ba Non erortze honen duintasunak Irikantatzera naraman Thank you.
batzuek ditugu satara, aitzen emoten gatoz herri honetara, aeroplanuan joateko asmuetan gara, bihar urtetzen dugu Ameriketara. Amairu lagun gera guztiok argiak, bezkaitu bildurtuko hotzak ez zeuriak, bizirikan etortzen bagera erdiak, kontauko dizuegu nukango berriak. Kaidia, ikusiko gaituzu agurka bidian, ondo utetzen bezku daukagun irian, ezkera etorriko beste urte bian. Nueva Yorkera guaz lehenengo rumbuan, handik Brasilera nio berri zurrenguan, gero Polo Nortera irugarrenguan, bazerra bilauko dugu badago munduan. Proposko galtzak, eskuetan harturi galtzairuzko lantzak, galdu ezkai ezenan otzak edo hartzak. Aparatu hauetien urte bian lana, hortan gastatu degun geure diru dana, biderako ere berriz bihar degu jana, horretik eskatzen degu herri altxo bana. Biderako ere berriz bihar degu jana, horretik eskatzen degu herri altxo bana, horretik eskatzen degu herri altxo bana.